I have told you guys stories in the past about Amanda Stewart, right? I've told you about her before. She was the one that got away from high school, my 11th grade crush. She had a sister that was in the 10th grade, just as cute. But there were problems. One problem, probably the most insurmountable problem, was the fact that she was Jehovah's Witness, which is fine. Nothing wrong with that. But in one of their faith distinct is that they don't date outside of the church. You know, Jehovah's Witness only date. And I was Presbyterian. I'm more than willing to convert. Okay. The bigger problem than that was the fact that I'd been friend zoned. You guys know what that is?
Mm-hmm.
Friend zone. The friend zone is impossible to get out. Yeah, you've been through that a bunch, man.
No, this is the thing I've heard this.
Okay. Well, I'm not going to tell the whole story. I just wanted to set some context. So she would, like, introduce me to her friends as her brother and stuff. And outside, I'd be laughing. Inside, I'd be like, oh, gosh, no. And I really, really was infatuated with this girl for a long, long time. It seemed like my whole high school career, just about. And my friends would be like, ask her out. I'm like, no. She could say no. That's humiliating. John knows that. Been through that a couple times. but they impressed upon me. They were like, look, the average human being lives something like 25,000 days, something like that. That's 70, 75 years, something like that. And they're like, you don't want to be that one person on day 24,999 who missed an opportunity. And so I asked her out, and she said yes. I was shocked. And so this is a 1992, 1993, Bram Stoker's Dracula was playing at the movie theater at Walnut Square Mall. And that was the movie I was going to take her to. And I'm not going to go into the whole, I think I've told you or some of you this story before. I'm not going to go into all that. But I just wanted to talk about why I thought Bram Stoker's Dracula was such a good pick for a date movie. I think it really is one of the greatest date movies you could possibly ever choose. One, because it's a horror. So you gotta take care of the lady, you know. And then two, it is one of the great love stories ever written as a romance. I mean, vampires are romantic, right? And so I'm gonna take her to see this. Well, it was great. The date was horrible, by the way, but the movie was fantastic. So
did you go back to brother mode?
What's that?
Did you go back to brother mode?
Oh yeah. But things were never the same after that either. Yeah. You know, it's like everything was kind of weird. But I often wonder. What she's doing now. real quick, I just want to show you something, and I will tell you at the start of it, what I'm looking for you getting out of this is I want you to be able to consider Bram Stoker's Dracula, and you're going to flesh out at least three of the major themes, okay? So let me show this to you, and keep that in mind.
In 1897, Bram Stoker penned one of the most culturally significant novels in the history of the English language, and perhaps the most important work of Gothic fiction of all time, Dracula. 2022 was an important anniversary, marking 125 years since Stoker wrote his classic, 100 years since the first major adaptation of his work, Nosferatu, and 30 years since his most commercially successful film adaptation, Bram Stoker's Dracula. Without a doubt, Bram Stoker's Dracula fits comfortably into the broad category of horror, but it's far more than that. On the surface, Dracula is a cultural phenomenon, introducing the vampire as a literary feature, villain, anti-hero, hero, and human reflection. It has spawned countless books and films with their own cultural and historical significance. The Hammer film and Universal Studios' interpretations of Dracula, Interview with a Vampire, and the rest of Anne Rice's filmography, Fright Night, The Blade Trilogy, From Dusk Till Dawn, 30 Days of Night, and The Lost Boys, and even family-friendly Pixar films, just to name a few. Few stories touch upon the great themes of humanity quite like this tale, and none, with the possible exception of The Exorcist, brings us face-to-face with the eternal themes of broken faith, good versus evil, redemption, and unconditional love. On the surface, Dracula tells the story of a medieval Christian prince who halts the invasions of the Saracens and the frontiers of Europe, becoming in a sense the savior of the West. Through espionage and duplicity, the would-be invaders, unable to defeat the prince on the field of battle, attack him in a far more personal way, convincing his one true love that he has perished in combat. In utter sorrow, she chooses to join him in death by taking her own life. When the prince returns home, he learns of the tragedy, but more so, learns that the church he has defended has cursed his bride for committing the unforgivable sin of suicide. The prince expels the clergy from his kingdom, renounces God, and in doing so, invokes a curse upon himself by which he must walk the world eternally alone, forever languishing in the memory of his long-lost love. He becomes a predator, a monster, feeding upon the blood of men in order to sustain his tortured life, till centuries later, when a chance encounter with lawyer John Harker brings him into the presence of Mina, who bears a striking resemblance to his true love and awakens within him a desire to believe and to live again. Dracula, then, explores the themes of good versus evil, faith, and redemption, each of which have become staples of the vampire genre, explored in other films like Twilight, Underworld, and Let the Right One In. But at the end of the day, it's a simple story of the curse of unconditional love.
Die. 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 I can't.
Now, who wants to go? Watch it.
Great movie. Really is. One of my top five favorites ever. I think up there with several of them in that clip. The Lost Boys is up there. I gave a shout out to The Exorcist. It's my favorite movie of all time.
I say you forgot Barnabas.
Yeah, Barnabas, right?
I watched that way back when.
So what I want you to do now, and you can work together on this and produce one document, whatever, I want you to take, we're going to take about 5 minutes, and I want you to design a movie poster. You can go online and look at examples. But this poster, I want you to flesh out at least three themes. I've mentioned some. You can Google themes in Bram Stoker's Dracula and you'll find others. But I want you to depict at least three, okay? We'll take 5 minutes. By the way, when you're doing a lesson like this and you're flipping, one of the characteristics of gifted learners is that they are often perfectionists and they are paralyzed by perfectionism, so they won't get started. So one thing that you can do is, as you're circulating and coaching and all that, you can prompt them, hey, let's get just something down. Or whatever. By the way, you don't have to do this either. You don't have to make a poster. If you want to write something, I think Tony Neely wrote a song lyric last block. If you want to design a social media page, if you want to just shoot me an idea, whatever. At the end of the day, I want you to be able to communicate to me that you know three themes from Bram Stoker's Dracula. Okay? 5 minutes. Feel free to talk. There are some exemplars in the back from previous lessons. All right, I'm going to go ahead and look at some of what we got here.
I've got embodiment of evil, which is corruption, life, death, temptation, and isolation.
That's good. There's several that I didn't mention. What about you, Miss Orr?
I was looking at an acronym. I don't know.
That runs from light. That's great. What you got over here? It's okay. It's just.
I just put love never waits because I thought that was important. Because she went over. She went
over. So we have the cross here. It represents the redemption, unconditional love. But then you have the bat.
Representing the DC universe.
Yes, representing the DC universe. Representing the good versus evil. And the broken faith.
Awesome. What's the door symbolize?
Fear of the outsiders.
Fear of the outsiders.
That's pretty good for the amount of time that you gave
us. Yeah.
Sorry, don't look at my to-do list.
It's awesome, awesome. Coach Stoker?
I have Hero and some songs in there, but I'm not going to sing. And then Faith, it's another song that I'm not going to sing, but that's George Michael, by the way.
Have faith, faith.
And love no matter what, it's unconditional love.
There we go.
Faith, good versus evil, and life and death.
Outstanding.
Good versus evil, love, faith, and tiny bats.
And Tiffany?
We've got our Dracula emblem here. Good versus evil, faith, and love.
What do you guys have? Explain to us.
Go, Brianna. This is good versus evil because there is a bad person and a good person. And in the movie, this is bad like curses and good like love.
Oh.
house and
you go
with the death
one. Oh, I get the death one?
Yeah.
Okay, so the death represents that she took her own life because of her unconditional love, and she wanted to join him.
And notice that she fleshed out one of the themes that we did not mention in the presentation. So she went a little bit further, you know, on that.
Hey, good job.
This is not a butt. This is a heart.
The last one is unconditional love. It's too big to fit on the page.
That's great.
Yeah.
The drawing that we made, it shows the conflict between good and evil with the blood dripping off his teeth, yet he feels love in his heart. And then the, what is this one?
The loss of faith.
Yeah.
With you know, just basically the dagger and the cross, but I put a little blood in with it.
Yeah.
And the final theme was, what?
Redemption.
Redemption. And this is his, he regained faith in life with when his love was rekindled for another.
Right. And at the end, if you remember, if you've ever seen the film or read the book, at the end, when spoiler alert, when he dies, when he finally dies and meets his death, he returns to human form. So he ultimately, because of the plight for love and all that, he's redeemed ultimately.
I've got loss of faith, heart, and loss, tears of loss. And a need for love, faith, and acceptance. And I relate that to Mary Shelley's Frankenstein.
Mm. Fantastic.
So I'm actually doing the movie poster, The Love Never Dies. So I'm going to, I like how there's like, half of you can't see because it's black. So I was just going to focus on what the parts that you can't see. So yeah, I like that. Show the actual theme.
Neely, what we got?
So I decided mine would be called Blinded by the Night. Ooh. The tagline is, exactly. The tagline is, lust made him a monster, love made him a man.
Oh,
thus the awful, horrible vampire erotica.
All right, so what I have is I'm going directly off of the themes because I'm not a good drawer, so I'm trying to do a visual representation of the themes. So the two themes that I'm working on right now is the duality between good versus evil. Mm-hmm. So eventually black will be mixed in here. This is the evil meshing with the white good that's pure, the two sides coming together, and then that is a broken cross representing the broken faith in our Dracula story.
Outstanding. All right, what we got here?
Everybody's better than mine.
It's all right.
All right, so far I've got my three keys for this. Going off the questions, I've got good versus evil. The movie I have for that is going to be the Blade Trilogy. I also want to represent love, so I'm using the original Dracula. And then retribution, I'm trying to figure out which one I want to go with. And then I'm going to have a almost like a podcast poster for them.
That's great. Retribution, that's not one of the things that I mentioned specifically. You know, so what you got there?
I'm going to work on a little good versus evil as my theme and working on a Google Slides presentation.
And then you went through and found other things too.
Other things.
Madness, money.
Just trying to pick one out.
All right. So, real quick, we just did a flip lesson, a little mini lesson. The rationale behind flipping is really simple, okay? In our traditional methods, let me turn this around. In our preparation programs, we're taught to basically, you know, pitch a unit. The unit's multi-lesson over the course of several days and usually culminating in a test of some sort, some kind of assessment. And what we've historically done, and I'm just as guilty, I mean, I was a social studies teacher, so I love to tell stories and get up there and present the content, but in class, we're focusing on the lower order of the taxonomy, right? The easy stuff, the knowledge, understanding, application. Just because it's lower order, by the way, doesn't mean it's not important. It's still foundational, but we were focusing on this, using our supervisory time to do this, and then traditionally turning kids loose to do this on their own, right? Through homework or whatever, or some sort of project. Well, classroom flipping inverts the approach there, where primacy is now being placed on the higher order thinking skills that we're doing in class under your supervision, and the kids now are responsible for the mini lesson, right? So theoretically, if this were a classroom that I taught, you guys would come in. I would have expected you to do the lesson the previous day. You're a human being. Human nature hasn't changed ever. And that means you didn't do the homework like I asked you to, likely, right? And so I build time into the lesson, usually the first 5 minutes, to, hey, go off and take the lesson, listen to it, whet your appetite, and then join in on the fun. The key, of course, is that you've got to make sure that the things that you're doing are more compelling than the hallways or than the environment. And if you go in like Miss Noffel's room, it's always compelling. Every day, she doesn't miss an opportunity to like inspire, motivate, and make kids see the stars. So, but the primacy is going to be placed on the higher order thinking skills inside the class under your supervision, and the lower order thinking skills are things that they're going to pursue on their own. Okay. Three basic considerations or rationale why we do this. First of all, we do this so that we can maximize class time. Again, I was a social studies teacher. Some of us like to be lectured to or like to listen to lecture. Typically, if I'm up there lecturing, I'm gonna spend some amount of time redirecting, right? You know, redirect, redirect, guide, and I'm doing that for a lot of kids. And you end up spending time teaching yourself, you know, regurgitating the content and a lot of redirecting. In a flipped classroom, the direct instruction portion of the lesson is completed at home or in an alternative setting, freeing up class time for conferencing, collaborating, and hands-on practice. Whenever we started too, I made the point to say, you know, feel free to collaborate and work together. I try never to pass up an opportunity for students to collaborate. That is one of the 21st century learning skills that are embedded in our performance standards and TEKS. The more that you can get students engaging in accountable talk with one another, the more they're going to learn. That's just a fact. Second consideration, now that you've freed up this class time, you can make the most of the time that you have through collaborating, teaching kids the process of how to learn, right? Kids need to be taught how to learn, how to collaborate, how to work together, how to have accountable discussions, sidebar discussions and stuff like that aren't the worst thing in the world, but you've got to teach them how to learn, essentially. And then finally, the most important is the quality of the peer-to-peer time, right? This is where you, as a facilitator, teacher facilitator, can go around and coach kids on their interactions and maximize their peer-to-peer engagement, which is, to me, more critical than the peer-to-teacher interaction. Okay, I'm going to show you this. Now, let me preface this. You probably have seen this before, and hey, guys in the back, there is going to be one bad word in here, okay? I apologize for that, so just earmuffs. You've probably seen this before, and I'm not naive. I understand there's probably some context to this that we're not aware of. The kid might be a jerk, but I want you to listen to what he's saying. And again, I think many of you have probably already seen this.
Turn this fucking lady go off on kids, because they don't freaking get this crap. If you would just get up and teach them instead of handing them a freaking package, yo. There's kids in here who don't learn like that. They need to learn face to face. Or you just get mad because I'm pointing out the obvious.
No, you're wasting my time.
No, I'm not wasting your time. Mm-hmm. I'm telling you what you need to do.
Get out.
You want kids to come into your class? You want them to get excited for this? You got to come in here. You got to make them excited. You want a kid to change and start doing better? You got to touch his freaking heart. Can't expect a kid to change if all you do is just tell him. You got to take this job serious. This is the future of this nation. And when you come in here, like you did last time, and make a statement about, oh, this is my paycheck, indeed it is. But this is my country's future and my education.
Can you go outside, please?
Score me.
But there's a limit. When I'm not bitching, but simply making an observation.
Okay.
And now I will leave. You're welcome. And if you would like, I'll teach you a little more so you can actually learn how to teach a freaking class. Because since I got here, I've done nothing but read packets. No. So don't try and take credibility for teaching me jack.
Just go
by.
Okay.
A little bit.
I mean, there's probably a backstory to this, right? but right. I mean, is he wrong, though? I mean, is the substance of what he's saying wrong? And I think that's one of the advantages, the inherent advantages of classroom flipping, is this allows you to nurture those relationships, your relationship with the kids, learning to get inside their mind, learn the amount of progress they're making towards mastery, and ultimately to inspire them. They said, you know, if you want a kid to learn, you gotta touch his heart, right? So classroom flipping allows you to do that, and pushes you to do that. A couple of basic ingredients, all right? The basic ingredients are, first of all, the pre-recorded mini lesson. Now, does it have to be a recorded video mini lesson? Is there anything sacred about that? No, it's just to me, it's convenient. We've got tools to do it. You can make something very simple and in very little time. You can do something as you get better and better at it. It can be real sophisticated. But what it does is it weans them off of you as the primary source of instructional delivery, and it also duplicates you. So a kid who's missed so many days can come in, and rather than you taking up your time trying to bring them up to speed, you put them off at the station, and he can then take the mini lesson and come in and join in the very compelling activity that you've got that he's going to want to be part of, right? So it duplicates you. It also allows a student who has varying degrees of competency to go back and rewatch over and over again. And I also should not give them everything. I'm a social studies guy, right? I get up there teaching about the Battle of Chickamauga, which I think is the greatest battle ever, and I want to tell them everything, right? I want to make sure that I don't leave anything out. That's what I'm inclined to do. With this really helps discipline you to economize your words, say enough to whet their appetite, and then you're spending the rest of the workshop period having the kids collaborate and going off and delving into the content and attaining it that way. All right, so the first ingredient is the mini lesson or whatever format you choose to do, a handout or whatever. Whatever you can do to take the requirement of delivering the content out of your hands and into their hands, all right? Second, we've got after consuming the lesson, after the student has completed, has consumed the content, it is the students doing the work. It's some sort of a workshop. It's task-based, skills-based, some sort of a project or something that's relevant and useful to them. One reason that we find in a lot of our classes that kids aren't, doing the work is they're not engaged by it. It doesn't seem relevant to them. It's boring. It's busy work, all right? So find ways to get them doing the labor in the class. One thing that Jesse Lawrence and I used to do, you guys know Jesse Lawrence, remember her? One of the greatest co-teachers ever. They literally dropped her on my front door, like, and said, here she is. She came over from Dade County, and they had, she was a tenured educator, but they didn't have a spot for her there, so they asked, hey, did Walker County, anybody take her? We took her. They dropped her on my door, said, here she is. One of the best co-teachers I've ever had, ever. Maybe the best. She was phenomenal. But one thing that we used to do during the work period is we would present exemplars. We'd make our own set of exemplars and show them up. But we found that kids would simply mimic those, right? They'd just copy the exemplar. This is what right looks like. This is what I'm going to do. So we stopped doing that, and we started joining the groups. She would join a group, I would join a group, and we would use that as an opportunity to collaborate with the kids, to push them, again, to coach them in their learning habits and how to learn from each other. So, but that was fun. So we've got some sort of prepackaged mini lesson that you can reuse. You've got a workshop where students are doing the labor, and then you've got class time being used to explore, inspect, and especially like in subjects with numbers, correcting misconceptions, right? The old saying, practice makes perfect. That's not true, it makes permanent. So a lot of the learning process is you going in and correcting misconceptions, and that's okay. But one thing I think that I really like about this too is this enables you to teach kids to embrace failure as part of the learning process, right? We want the kids to make mistakes. That's how they're learning. Oh, you've done this incorrectly this many times. Let's go back and fix the problem and do it right and learn to master it that way. But we need to teach kids to embrace failure as part of the process. You can even consider doing something like a failure board, like the greatest fails of the week and all that kind of stuff, and just have fun with it. And again, one of the things I always tell people, is Miss Curry in here? She's not in here. She asked me to send her my max, because one of them is don't take yourself too seriously or get over yourself, right? Teach kids to do the same, embrace failure. Sorry about that. A few qualifications, and then we're almost done. Classroom flipping is not a panacea, okay? It's not a cure for all ills. You're still gonna have kids who have human natures come in and have bad days and get distracted and all that. We're gonna minimize that and make it happen less and less, but it's still gonna happen, all right? Bad teaching is still bad teaching. You take a bad teacher and put them in a flipped classroom, you've got a bad flipped classroom, okay? So we have to make sure that we're using our best practices and continuously honing our craft. And effective flipping requires time and preparation. Don't feel like you gotta go home today and do the rest of the 13 weeks or more over in canned mini lessons. It takes time. Start slowly. Allison Eisenberg and I built a Georgia Studies classroom when you were there, I think. And I remember at the time we were using like Wiki Spaces, I think, or Moodle or something like that. But the substance of the architecture we spent 2 years doing that. Like, we spent one full summer recording lessons, making little slide presentations, cutting them into 5-minute consumable bits. And then we spent the next year just perfecting it, like making it better and better and better. And we had this architecture that we could use to duplicate us, but it took time. So this is something where, you know, the best time to start is now, and don't feel like you have to do everything. You'll get better and more competent at that also. Be prepared to invest time in it, all right?
Every day, 7.2 million students walk into classrooms throughout the United States. These classrooms generally look the same. 30 students sit in rows of desks, taking notes in their notebooks, while the teacher stands at a whiteboard teaching a lesson. Regardless of ability level, each student receives the exact same information at the exact same pace. As Ms. Jackson presents the same material, the students respond differently. Tommy gets it, while Allison is bored, and Maria is lost. At the end of the day, these same students head home. While at home, they sit at the kitchen table doing their homework and trying to remember what Ms. Jackson said. Students like Tommy make it most of the way through the homework, while others, like Allison, find it easy and fly through it. At the same time, students like Maria get frustrated and need some extra help. Ms. Jackson recognizes that students have different needs and would love to work individually with each student, but this requires time and resources that her school does not have. One solution to this problem is the flipped classroom. Here's what it looks like. While at home, students sit in their rooms watching videos of the lesson that Ms. Jackson assigned. Tommy is still able to work at his normal pace. Allison is no longer bored because now she can use this new technology to fast forward through the easy material. And Maria is no longer frustrated because she can review the material that she didn't understand by pausing and rewinding. When she really gets stuck, she can get help from her classmates. New technology platforms like Moodle and Edmodo make it easy for her to chat online with her classmates. Just as the homework is different, the classroom is different as well. Instead of standing in front of the room speaking, Ms. Jackson walks around the room. She checks in with Tommy as he works collaboratively with some students. She pushes Allison further with some more challenging work. And she helps Maria with the pieces that she still doesn't quite get. In the traditional model, the teacher stands between the students and the knowledge. But with the flipped classroom model, the students have direct access to the knowledge, and the teacher serves as a coach, mentor, and guide, helping the students access this knowledge. The flipped classroom leverages technology in a way that lets both Ms. Jackson and the students make the most of their time and efforts.
That's pretty much it, right? You just, the mini lesson that duplicates you, that kids can go use, reuse, and be independent from you on that. The workstations or the work time, and then correcting misconceptions, practicing, and celebrating failure. All right, any questions? Pretty intuitive, right? I mean, there's nothing very controversial about it, anything I said. Remember, differentiation is not a tactic, it's not a strategy. Differentiation is a worldview. It's an approach to instruction and how you teach, right? Got 4 kids, anybody here who's got multiple kids know that your kids are different from each other. Even with the same parents, your kids are different. They have different personalities. Piper is very sweet. She gets her feelings hurt real easy, but she's real creative. Petra, my little one, is mean. I mean, she's a daddy's girl, but she's mean. And the way I engage her is way different than the way I engage Piper. And then my oldest daughter, Ella, she's mean too. She's just, I mean, she'll know. I mean, golly, man. Whew. She's very smart, probably the smartest of all of them, but she was mean. The way that I dealt with Noah and Piper, completely different than the way I engage Ella, because you don't teach people axiomatically the same. You teach them in a way that's consistent with their nature. And I think that's what flipping allows you to do. It allows you to meet kids where they're at according to their nature and forces you to differentiate. It's inherently differentiated. When you flip, the environment becomes an inescapable environment of differentiation. Okay? Yes.
If you have trouble with kids who don't like to pay attention to videos and stuff like that, if you video at home or like in your living room, whatever, they are wildly curious. Because I filmed stuff that I used with Hannah's class a few years ago, and they were like, "Is that your Christmas tree?" And I was like, "That's what you got out of the video. You need to watch it again." But they were just enraptured. I mean, they at least paid attention to the, you know, they watched it in school.
One thing you could do too, Paula, is you could actually have the kids curate the content for you. That's what these, you know, Generation Z kids are not just consumers of content, they're content creators now. So one way to save you some time maybe is outsource the making of the tools and you can reuse them. And then you've got the kids talking about it and engaging the content, and usually one another too. They like to do it. So, good point. Anything else? Well, thanks for coming.